Hi guys, welcome back. Today we're going to continue our discussion from the previous episode. And if you haven't seen it yet, I would advise that you pause this video and go back to the beginning of the series. Remember, it is designed as a continuous course, and watching individual episodes in random order might not make too much sense to you. But for the rest of you, as you might remember, we said that I went to the gym for the first time in my life and lifted 10-pound dumbbell as many times as I could, which was 10, for example. Then I went home, recovered, and then supercompensated up to this point. And since my performance ability increased, we can say that at this point, I am able to lift that 10-pound dumbbell 11 times. You might also remember that we said that it is optimal for me to go back to training right at this point right here. And let's say that I did. I went to the gym and I lifted the same 10-pound dumbbell 10 times again. Now you can imagine that this would no longer be as challenging for me, which means that my body might not feel any need to further adapt. There is an expression that is perfect for this scenario, and it says, if you always do what you have always done, you will always get what you have always gotten. Meaning that if I just keep repeating the same training routine over and over and over again, at best, I will just stay at the same performance level. There are a few main ways for me to make my training more challenging. The first one is to increase intensity. Intensity has various definitions, but for the purposes of this discussion, we're just gonna say that higher intensity means lifting heavier weight. So going back to our example, instead of lifting 10-pound dumbbell, next time I would lift 15-pound dumbbell. And then once that becomes easy, I would move on to 20-pound dumbbell, and so on. The second way for me to make my training more difficult is to increase volume. The volume is the combined amount of reps and sets that you do during training session. So in our example, when I go back to the gym, instead of lifting that 10-pound dumbbell 10 times, I'm gonna lift it 11 times now. And then with each successive session, I'm gonna do more and more reps. Although that would definitely work for some time, you have to imagine that after a certain point, I would be lifting that 10-pound dumbbell hundreds and hundreds of times. And my training will slowly start to resemble a marathon. Now, if you look at marathon runners, it should be pretty clear that this is not the best way to get big and strong. On the other hand, if you look at the strongman competitors, it should be pretty obvious that there is a direct relationship between being bigger and stronger. So this is why we're gonna say that although the volume of your training will increase as you become more and more advanced, we're still gonna say that increasing the intensity is the preferred mode of progressive overload. This discussion reminds me of the time when I was doing boxing and I was always getting yelled at by my very mean boxing coach for goofing off on the punching bag. If you ever saw somebody working on a punching bag, you know that most of the time there's really not much going on. Guys just kind of throw a jab, then move their head like they Floyd Mayweather or something, and make serious faces because they think that all the girls are looking at them. And what my boxing coach was saying was that in an amateur boxing match, you only have three-minute rounds to show all you got. And nobody really cares that you had 20 more rounds in you. And that's why you have to train accordingly. And as I proceeded to find out, it actually is much harder to go all out on that punching bag for 3 minutes, for three rounds, versus just dancing around for 2 hours. And the same applies to resistance training. If you're familiar with my hypertrophy phase, just thinking about leg day gives me goosebumps. First, you fry your quads with leg extensions, then your legs go completely numb after leg press, and then once you get to the squat, even on the warm-up sets, you already feel like you're gonna pass out. And then when you get to the work set, you put that weight on your shoulder and you don't think you even can do one rep, but you have to do 12. And once that's over, you have two more sets. And although the whole training session is 15 combined sets, it is nothing less than a nightmare. And it is actually much easier just to keep pumping set after set after set while looking at your phone and socializing a little bit. And this is why most guys will gravitate towards the increasing the volume as a primary mode of progressive overload. But the thing is that after some point, that kind of training will become less and less effective. And on top of that, it will beat up your joints, and you will remember about this once you get a little older. The third way for me to make my training more challenging would be by increasing frequency. Frequency basically means how often you train. That could be applied to you training as a whole or the training of individual body parts. In either case, if I was to use increasing of the frequency as a primary mode of progressive overload, I would quickly run out of room, because once I train 7 days a week, there is really nowhere else for me to go. Besides, as you might remember from our SRA discussion, how often do I train will depend on how long it takes for me to recover and not so much on how much free time I have. So this is why we're not going to consider frequency as a primary mode of progressive overload. The last one on this list is decreasing rest breaks between sets. I'm sure you can imagine that it's very different when you get to rest 5 minutes between your sets of squats and when you get to rest 30 seconds. And although this definitely has implications, especially during hypertrophy training, just like with frequency, the room for us to maneuver is very limited. Because if we just kept pushing this issue, at some point our rest breaks would be at zero. So this is why, once again, decreasing the rest breaks will not be considered as a primary mode of progressive overload. Obviously, there are many other ways to make your training harder, and I listed some of them right here. We have partial reps, force reps, rest pause, drop sets, and supersets. And the reason why I don't include these as a primary modes of progressive overload is due to their unsustainability. Let's take supersets for example. Obviously, combining two exercises in a superset would make your training harder. But how to take it further? Tri-set, then giant set, and then before you know it, you are flirting with overtraining, because all of these are very, very taxing. And this is why I like to think of them as shock techniques, which are to be used very infrequently and preferably only for stubborn body parts. Besides sustainability, we'll also have to take into account measurability, which means that you have to be able to objectively see how you are progressing, whether that be doing more reps with the same weight or using more weight for the same amount of reps. In the real life, training is a little more complicated than just going to the gym and doing 10 curls. Most of us use multiple exercises and perform multiple sets in each. So no matter how good your memory is, it is very unlikely that you will remember all the sets, reps, and weights for all of those exercises. And I'm not just talking about remembering what you did in the bench press last week. You should be able to see how you are progressing over periods of weeks or even months. And this is why I designed Big and Strong app, to help people keep track of their training progress, especially if you're using one of my training programs. We're going to finish this episode by talking about various loading patterns. This is something that is discussed in great detail in Practical Programming by Mark Rippetoe, which is, in my opinion, one of the best strength training books ever written. And we're going to start our discussion by talking about novice lifters. Life of a novice lifter is very straightforward. All you have to do is train just a little harder, hopefully by lifting slightly more weight at each successive training session. This is referred to as linear progression, and is really that simple. Which is perfect, because it gives novices time to focus on the most important task of that stage of their career, which is to learn the proper technique for all the main exercises. We are now going to move on to intermediate level, which roughly speaking begins after 1 year of training. Due to progressive overload, our training sessions become more and more demanding at this time, which in turn will stretch out the SRA curve, as you can see. If you are a proponent of a heavy-duty methodology, at this time you might consider training very, very infrequently. But a more conventional approach dictates that you start to intersperse light training sessions with heavy training sessions to balance out your training with your recovery. Another way to go about it would be by utilizing some kind of undulating loading pattern. And if you're familiar with my advanced training program, that would be a good example of one. As you can see, I move the line of overtraining a little lower because our resilience to training increases at this time. Still, however, you should be able to see that with our training sessions becoming more and more demanding, we're getting closer to this line. And all that basically means is there are more ways to screw things up at this point. We are now entering the advanced level. There are no particular number of years that makes you an advanced athlete. And all I can tell you is that most people never actually make it to this stage. At the advanced level, the amount of work that is required to evoke further adaptation is so great that it's no longer practical to perform it all within one training session. This is why something called concentrated loading is usually being utilized. And what that means is that fatigue is purposely being accumulated over the period of few consecutive training sessions, after which period of deload usually follows to allow the recovery to take place. You might notice that I no longer have days of the week marked on the x-axis here. This is because all this will take place over a period of at least a few weeks. You might also notice that I moved our overtraining line even lower now. Still, however, our training is becoming so demanding that we definitely are getting closer to it now. Which means that at the advanced level, room for error is much, much smaller. But I think we complicated things enough for one episode, and it's probably a good time for us to take a break. So thank you guys for watching, and I'll see you next time.